of the 55th Public Lecture Series for this semester, celebrating 30 years of research at the Archaeological Research Unit of the University of Cyprus. It is a pleasure to introduce our today's speaker, the most recent member of the Archaeological Research Unit, Professor Apostolos Saris, who joined the Department of History and Archaeology of the University of Cyprus in September 2019. Professor Saris studied astronomy and physics at Boston University, and he obtained his PhD in physics and geophysics from the University of Nebraska-Lincoln in the United States. He is professor of the Sylvia Ioannou Chair on Digital Humanities in the Department of History and Archaeology of the University of Cyprus, and research director and head of the Laboratory of Geophysical Satellite Remote Sensing and Archaeoenvironment at the Foundation of Research and Technology in Crete. He is also adjunct professor at the Cyprus University of Technology and a research associate of the Department of Anthropology at the Field Museum of Natural History of Chicago, Illinois. He has been a senior Marie Curie Fellow of the European Union at the Institute for Advanced Studies at Freiburg University, as well as research fellow and a visiting senior researcher at Leiden University. Apostolos Saris acted as a vice president of the European section of the Archaeological Remote Sensing Consortium, vice chair of the International Society of Archaeological Prospection, and president of the Computer Applications in Archaeology Greek section. He is currently treasurer of the International Union of the Prehistoric and Protohistoric Sciences, an associate editor of the Society for Archaeological Sciences Bulletin, of the Archaeological and Anthropological Sciences Journal, and the Archaeological Prospection Journal. He is member of scientific experts and evaluation committees for the European Research Council Executive Agency, the Russian Science Foundation, the National Center of Science and Technology of the Republic of Kazakhstan, the Netherlands Organization for Scientific Research, the Hellenic Foundation for Research and Innovation, and other organizations and funding bodies. He has organized, planned, and participated in more than 250 geophysical satellite remote sensing and GIS projects in Greece, the United States, Cyprus, Hungary, Albania, Germany, Italy, Turkey, and Egypt, and has participated in more than 100 Greek, European, and international large-scale projects. His research has produced more than 300 publications and has provided practical training to more than 1,000 students from Greek and foreign universities from several countries across Europe. His today's lecture focuses on only one of his numerous interdisciplinary field projects, namely Neolithic Thessaly, and we all look forward to his presentation. I would also like to kindly ask you to keep your microphones muted and your cameras off during the duration of the lecture. You are free to switch them on again and unmute yourselves in case you wish to address a question or comment to our speaker, or use the chat function, the chat window during the Q&A session. Thank you very much, Apostol. Off to you.
I want to thank you so much for your kind introduction. I hope you can see my screen. I would like also to thank all of you for joining us today for the last presentation of this public event. And I want to give my big thanks to the Sylvia Ioannou Foundation that made it possible to create the Sylvia Ioannou Chair for Digital Humanities here, the Department of History and Archaeology, where we started to develop a new graduate program and also a new laboratory on geoinformatics and digital humanities. All the members of the Department of History and Archaeology have embraced and supported this effort, and I am really indebted to each one of them. As I arrived at the University of Cyprus about a year and a half ago, it is obvious that my current presentation will be dealing with parts of research that have been initiated at the Geosat Research Lab at Fort and continue here as well.
Apostolos, sorry, may I interrupt you? Is it possible that you use a microphone? Instead of your,
I can try.
We can hear you, but not very clearly. There is a...
Give me a minute, just in case, so I can make the adjustments.
Yes, can you go on so that you
tell me if it is better without
it? Is better. It is better. Thank you, Apostle.
Okay, perfect. No problem at all. So, what I have chosen to present here is a research work that tackles the landscape of Neolithic Thessaly, as it is one of the best examples of how the manifold employment of geoinformatics, as it has been applied from space, air, and land, can address specific archaeological questions. During the 7th to 4th millennia before Christ, Thessaly became the landing states of immigrants that arrived in different waves of migration and started settling mainly in the fertile valleys of Larissa and Kargotsa. The massive movement of the people that was accompanied also with advancements of the agricultural technology from fertile Crescent to Europe was initiated in the early Neolithic. Studying the landscape of the region at a particular period is crucial in understanding the Neolithization trajectory in Europe. Exploration of the Neolithic landscape in Thessaly was initiated in the beginning of the 20th century. Based on the developments of that period, there was an effort to create an inventory of the existing Neolithic sites, emphasizing the tells, the so-called marules, a work that fueled the study of the environmental aspects of the settlements during the Neolithic period. It was the work of Halsted, Van Andel, Reynolds, and Perles that made the first efforts to associate the Neolithic settlement patterns with the geographic, topographic, and physiographic attributes of the landscape.
Apostle, I'm sorry again. Do you have another set of microphones? This is still not good.
This is still not good. Okay, let me try another one. Let's see which one is going to work.
Is your connection, Apostole?
I think it might be the ventilator of the computer that makes a kind of background noise. If you hear something like wind sound or something like that.
Απόστολε, μήπως έχεις ενεργοποιημένα ηχεία?
Ναι. Ωραία. So, we'll find the questions in one way or the other. Panasia, I don't think this will work out. Huh?
Okay, we can. Σε ακούμε κάπως καλύτερα. Εάν προσπαθήσεις να μιλάς πιο κοντά στο μικρόφωνο, ίσως αυτό να διορθώσει το πρόβλημα.
Okay. I don't know exactly what you're hearing. If it is a kind of a buzz sound. Kind of a buffer or something like that, but yes. Yeah, right. So the research domain that has been during the beginning of last century and continued with more efforts of dealing with respect to the topographic and geographic attributes of the landscape was even expanded through a number of excavations that have been contacted by the local archaeological services of antiquity. And especially through the rescue excavations along the course of the gutter construction works, the National Road or the Lake Harlem. All these strategies all changed the last 15 years. And there was a recent trend of large-scale investigations trying to incorporate a more robust and multidisciplinary approach for the study of the Neolithic landscape. This research, led by the Geosat Research Lab and the effort of Antiquities of Volos, involved the involvement of satellite remote sensing and historical aerial imagery, GIS spatial analysis for the study of the settlement patterns, geophysical prospection techniques, and others. Even more recently, the long-time NOSI research project, materialized by the effort of Antiquities of Karditsa, focuses on the habitation patterns in the area of Campos using remote sensing and geoarchaeological approaches in tandem to intensive surface surveys. A lot still has to be learned from future investigation of the region, and the archaeological excavations have a critical role. For the meantime, though, let us focus on our research, the early stages of which started with the construction of an updated archive of the accurate location of the known archaeological sites through an extensive GPS survey. About 342 sites were mapped, and their geomorphological attributes allowed the study of their distribution in the different topographical zones, especially, and the dynamics of the habitation patterns through the use of multi-criteria spatial analysis in a GIS environment. Dimitris Alexakis, along the course of his PhD, made use of multispectral and hyperspectral imagery for the further detection of the sites, which also continued with the later efforts of Athos Agapiou through the study of specific spectral signatures of the sites from recently launched satellite platforms such as Formosa 2 and Sentinel 2. As the LTNS project indicated, the human interventions of the landscape, especially those carried out last century, have transformed the terrain, destroyed a large quantity of the archaeological record, making it necessary to go back to older archives. In this aspect, historical aerial pictures and satellite imagery can help to recover some of the lost traces of the prehistoric settlements. Except the historical aerial imagery of the Geographical Service of the Greek Army, a corpus of Royal Air Force images has become available through the British School of Athens. The georeferencing of the particular images of low altitude especially has been revealing with respect to the identification of a number of details that may be related to past Magoules that were destroyed in the recent years, either due to urban sprawl or leveling of the land for cultivation purposes. It is expected, however, that these historical images are not able to cover the whole region of interest. In order to have such a more integrated archive that can cover most of the regions of Greece, we progressed with the construction of the Corona Atlas of Greece, an atlas that comprises of about 193 individual Corona United States intelligence images, ranging in dates from 1961 to 1972, which have been extracted during the different missions over the course of the Corona program, mainly by cameras Keyhole 2 to Keyhole 4B, spanning in spatial resolution from 1.8 to 7.5 meters. Having a better image of the existing situation of the spread of the Neolithic settlements, it became necessary to focus on the settlements themselves, the internal organization, and the dynamic relation with their surrounding environments. The Aristia Aegean project took the lead in this direction through the employment of ground-based geophysical approaches coupled with high-resolution satellite and aerial remote sensing images. The manifold protocol that was followed included magnetic soil resistance, ground-penetrating radar, and electromagnetic induction techniques. The extensive mapping of the sites was achieved through the magnetic multisensory techniques used for the first time in Eastern Mediterranean, employing 8 flux-gate radiometers, a dense spacing navigated through a differential GPS unit, and thus being able to collect data every 1 to 10 centimeters along the transects. Single antenna and multi-channel GPR systems were employed for the acquisition of the stratigraphical data. Electromagnetic induction instruments measured the soil conductivity and magnetic susceptibility at different depths. Soil cores were also collected from different sections and depths of the sites, and their magnetic susceptibility and phosphate concentration were measured. The above methods targeted 21 Neolithic settlements, spanning from 4 habitation mounds to large, extensive settlements of several hectares in size. In total, the project scanned more than 700,000 square meters with magnetic techniques and almost 2 square kilometers with drones. The dating of the sites was provided by the diagnostic surface material that was collected by the team of the Archaeological Service of Volos, led by Kostas Bouraxakis and Vasa Rodiri. What can we get out of all these millions of point measurements and data sets? I will skip the processing that has been carried out for each one of the techniques employed, and I shall jump directly to the results we got. Similarly, as it is impossible to review all of the sites, we shall focus to a few representative ones. And we shall start with early Neolithic to middle Neolithic Magulia of Palmyros II, located in the area of the flat agricultural floodplains and stream beds about 2 kilometers south of the village of Palmyros. The magnetic measurements indicate that we are dealing with a settlement of about 54 by 48 meters in size. The core of the settlement consists of about 12 rectilinear structures and seems to be confined within a minor oval-shaped enclosure wall of about 1.5 meters width. The magnetic susceptibility measurements confirm the existence of an unbuilt area about 1,000 square meters in size to the north of the core of the settlement. The settlement spreads further away from the inner enclosure towards the south and east. The structures registered as high magnetic anomalies suggest that they are made by dough and they are burnt. 2 to 3 outer enclosures with width spanning from 7 to 14 meters probably represent ditches surrounding the settlement. Along the perimeter of the outer ditch, we have signs of entrances, some of which are baffled gates.
Apostole, I'm sorry again. Can you switch your camera off? Maybe that will help your internet keep going. Maybe there are short interruptions in your connection, I think. I cannot hear you very well either.
Let me try to do that as well.
Just shut your camera off, switch your camera off. And perhaps we can hear you better now. Thank you.
Better now.
Well, there is still an echo sort of in the background, but that has to do with your microphone.
Well, I'm afraid you have to suffer with me. Sorry about it.
Okay, please go on.
Neolithic early Bronze Age settlement of the Zomilar Stung spreads over an extensive circular hill reaching an altitude of 8 meters. The hill is located in the middle of the floodplain in close proximity to Lake Karlan. The magnetic survey covered an area of about 10.5 hectares, and the traces that appeared made us consider that it could have been used as a landing place of Star Trek's Starship Enterprise. However, a closer look at the data indicates that the settlement spreads over a circular area of about 250 meters in diameter, consisting of a series of 2 to 3 concentric ditches with widths of about 3 to 5 meters, reaching a depth of about 1.7 meters. Within these external ditches, another series of thinner enclosures appear, about 2 meters wide. 4 main gates to the settlement appear to both the ditches and the enclosure walls. Rectangular structures, some of them consisting of two rooms, appear in different sections of the Magulla. A smaller cluster of concentric enclosures becomes also apparent towards the east section of the main Magulla, suggesting a satellite settlement. To the north, the amorphous linear magnetic signals may be related to residues of past flooding episodes of Lake Karla. Magulla Almeriotiki has been the locus of a persistent habitation from the early Neolithic to the late Bronze Age. It is located about 4 kilometers from the present coastline, much further than the Neolithic coastline, in an area consisting of swamps and marshlands. The geomagnetic survey showed the traces of the past habitation extending over a region of about 300 to 200 meters. At the top of the Magulla, about 37 burnt rectangular dolomite structures spread around the perimeter of a circular ring about 100 meters in diameter, leaving an empty space at the center of the Magulla. Around this densely occupied nucleus, a more extended flat settlement expands towards the lower outskirts, confined by a series of ditches enclosing the settlement. Most of the structural remains exhibit a different magnetic signature. They have similar dimensions with those of the core settlement. They are rectangular, partitioned in two compartments, most probably have stone foundations, and they are not burned. About 60 such structural remains have been identified and seem to be oriented overlooking the center of the Magulla. The magnetic susceptibility in analysis of the soil samples taken from cores show that the top of the cultural layer is reached within the first 35 centimeters below the ground surface. Furthermore, the ditch system that encircles the settlement seems to have undergone different phases of construction. Double parallel ditches appear towards the east and the south sides of the settlement. There is an obvious expansion of them towards the west in an effort to encircle most of the extended settlement. To the north, their magnetic signatures become fuzzy, and both magnetic and electromagnetic measurements indicated that their fading signal may have been caused by post-deposition processes, most likely eroded due to subsequent flooding episodes. Moving further inland, towards the west part of Almiros Plain, the settlement of Pertica I, Daoucha, expands along the diverse environment of agricultural floodplains and large riverbeds. The core of the habitation seems to be confined within an area of 33 meters in diameter at the top of the Magulla, consisting of about 12 structures showing signs of burning. Structures are packed towards the west section, leaving an empty area towards the east. All methods confirm the absence of any architecture at this part of the site. The rest of the flat settlement expands towards the west, east, and south outside the Magulla. About 52 burnt oak structures are found dispersed, but sometimes also aligned along strips with an orientation towards north. Within the same area, a number of low magnetic intensity rectangular buildings partitioned in two rooms suggest a different occupation phase. The houses respect the same alignment to the north as the rest of burnt oak structures. 25 such houses have been recognized, having a size ranging from 14 to 80 square meters. Magnetic and EMI techniques confirm the existence of a system of 1 to 2 enclosures that encircle the flat settlement and which are most evident towards the north part of the site. Our final example will come from Pertica II, located on a steep natural hill about 800 meters northwest of the Pertica I. The topographic settings of the site are quite different from the rest of the settlement examined, indicating a different mode of activity. Despite the fun we all had in surveying the steep slopes of the site, the results were rather rewarding. A complex system of enclosures is the prominent characteristic of the site. some of them create internal divisions, while a number of entrances are also apparent. Some of them, they are about 6 meters wide and appear to be opposite to each other, allowing a direct crossing of the settlement. The internal system of the enclosures, having dimensions of about 63 by 55 meters, seems to have been the nucleus of the settlement, although lacking a distribution of buildings. A few structures, some adjacent to each other, have been clearly outlined in the GPR data. They may have stone foundations as they were exhibited as strong reflectors located about 17 centimeters below the surface. The outer enclosure follows a more elliptical path, expanding towards the lower slopes to the east. Magnetic susceptibility measurements were on the average level, in contrast, however, to the phosphate concentration that was relatively high, may be suggestive of animal husbandry activities at a specific site. So, where do all these leaders? If people can find the meaning behind the abstract expressionist painting of Jackson Pollock, I'm sure that you would have no difficulty to realize the richness and the details of the results obtained. It is the first time, with the help of ground-based remote sensing techniques, that we are able to reveal the spatial organization of a large number of monolithic settlements in Eastern Thessaly. The manifold geophysical approaches helped us to conceptualize the settlement planning and obtain indications regarding the dimensions of the structures, the extent of the settlements, the density and distribution of the structures, the relation between burned old maiden and burned stone foundation dwellings, the existence and the location of open and unbuilt spaces, suggestions about the negotiation of the settlements with their surrounding environs and the coexistence of tells and flood sites. The landscape of Neolithic Thessaly is indeed a landscape of diversity. There are still a few dimensions of the results of the research that we may want to look at more thoroughly. One of them is related to the signs of the burned houses, which actually register well to the magnetic measurements in most of the surveyed settlements. Burning of the houses in Southeast Europe is a common occurrence and has been noticed as early as 1999 by Chapman. Recent excavations by Attila Duca at the large burnt log house S81 of the late Neolithic Czechalin-Kovatskalin settlement in Hungary showed no halo of debris around the foundations of the house, suggesting that the burning was intentional, with its external walls having been collapsed within its interior. Similar residues were also found in the excavation of the early Neolithic settlement of Slatina Portera, Sofia, Bulgaria, where the temperature of fire would require 1200 degrees Celsius, which can be achieved only through the placing of large quantities of wood inside the houses. Recent magnetic and magnetic susceptibility studies of the Neolithic site of Mursalevo, the Bebods, in Bulgaria suggested the firing temperature reaching 1140 degrees Celsius, which can be achieved only through the combustion of the iron oxides of the dough when mixed with wood, dung, and urine. It has been noticed, though, that firewood was a rare resource in the area, meaning that there had been some kind of communal effort to reach a specific resource. Experiments made by Giorgio, based on the construction attributes of Chalcolithic dwellings in the lower Dunav, verified the above and advocated that burning of the houses was controlled, suggesting that a part of the building material, which has not been in contact with fire, would have been washed away by weathering or would have created amorphous clay layers. Actually, such kind of intense but fuzzy magnetic signatures extending over large areas were noticed in a survey at Idomeni Kilkis and were suggested to be associated with dog-meat houses of more historical settlements, mainly Mahalaves, that were burned down and abandoned during the Balkan Wars. It is thus most probable to suggest that the intense magnetic signals that outline clearly some Neolithic houses may be also indicative of intentional burning, and they don't create such kind of a signature at all. At the same time, the intense magnetic signals produced by both the burned houses and the white ditches were chosen for further experiments through machine learning techniques to try to automatically classify the particular features. Various algorithms and methods have been tried using classifiers such as supervised random forest or BlueNet convolutional neural networks. And as the particular method requires a high number of images for the training of the algorithms, a tagged database of images from Greece and the rest of the Balkans is under preparation in order to feed the algorithms and increase the validity of the segmentation process that can be used in the future investigations of similar sites. Most intriguing, though, remains the systematic existence of enclosures, which can be identified with white ditches, an observation that was made by Yorgos Preksis since 2006. Encircling walls and ditches have been found in many Neolithic settlements since early Neolithic period. Ατζημισιώτικη, Δημίνη, Οτζάκη, Πευκάκη, Αγιά Σοφιά, Χίλιον, Ατρίγιαλο, just to name a few. In the past, there have been a number of hypotheses suggested for the function of the ditches. Demarcation of the space, defensive constructions, against increased warfare, animal husbandry, confinements or storage for water, burial grounds or symbolic features. It is questionable though if these large constructions, which are found all over the Balkans and which required a large systematic communal activation and time investment to be constructed and maintained, were simply acting as a demarcation boundaries of a settlement. Rakski and Thunders moved even a step further, suggesting that this kind of communal effort and tuning of the population would suggest some kind of organization. Evidence of similar negotiation with the environment can be found all over the Balkans. The Neolithic Delt settlement, Sultana Malurosu, and Kaspio Arale, Ostrovel in Romania, located next to riverbeds. The settlements from Vidra, next to the floodplains of Sabat River, and Teiu, next to Mozaku River in South Romania, the site of Opoliste in Vosoko area in central Bosnia, and others. The last case, not only it was proven that the ditches were not only used for intensively for waste disposal, as the pits close to the houses, but a team of dry frogs suggested that they were backfilled and renewed every approximately 40 years. It is true, though, that most of the settlements found with ditches exist in the plains or in the proximity of paleoid channels. Is it possible that these earthworks were functioning as flood countermeasures within the hydrological landscape, especially if in our case, we take into account the multiple flooding episodes of the Neos River and Lake Karla? In the recent years, extensive flooding events in Thessaly have been reported to happen with a periodicity of about one per decade. Kypreou provides a time series of catastrophic flooding events that go back to 1684, signifying that the Pineos River exhibits catastrophic flooding episodes every 25 to 50 years or even less. Even the cities of Larissa and Brikala have experienced massive damages due to extreme flooding events in the past, meaning that the water level had to rise above 6 meters, reaching the 8 meters above mean river level. There are a number of studies that they have been carried out to study the hazard maps and flood risk maps in the Rio Thessaly. In our case, the flooding simulation was carried out through spatial modeling by taking into account a number of variables such as slope, flow direction and accumulation, the topographic wetness index, and the relative stream value elevation, taking into account also the porosity of the soil as it affects water infiltration capacity and the hydrological formations that span from impermeable formations to high permeability alluvial deposits. Two different approaches were applied. First, the definition of the flood hazard zones based on a combination of the particular geometric attributes, and second, the flooding simulation for Lake Carlin. The definition of the flood-prone areas was tested on five different digital elevation models derived either from optical or radar satellite and aerial platforms, having a spatial resolution from 5 to 30 meters. The 5 meter Greek National Cadastral and 12 meter German Aerospace Center Tandem XDEMs were those of better resolution. The enhanced resolution of the DEM becomes crucial when we calculate the relative height above rivers and combine it with other geomorphometric indices, such as the potential wetness index. The results of the analysis manifest that most of the neolithic settlements that they were established in the plains were in close proximity to the rivers and definitely within flooding prone areas. At the same time, our results are even more conservative than the more aggressive or generalized European Joint Research Center model of 2% annual chance flood event, namely a retained period of 50 years. We can thus depict the persistence of habitation in the particular flood prone areas throughout the Neolithic period. Zooming through particular sections of the flooding prone areas, we can even detect the association of the details of the construction of the surrounding ditches with the direction of flooding. We can see, for example, the wide double ditch system of Amiliotiki Magoula expanding mainly towards the west and south directions, and the ditches of Magoula Visviki expanding towards the northeast direction where Lake Karla is located. So it's actually they are constructed waiting for the flooding to come, to arrive. The water level of the Karla Lake has also changed intensively during the prehistoric period. Grundmann provided the suggestion that the water level was about 64 meters in the prehistoric period, compared to the 44 meters in the modern period. On the other hand, Haley indicated that in its maximum extension, the lake would be consisting of smaller or larger depressions that were having a water level between 42 to 64 meters, most probably as a consequence of the climatic optimum. According to Apostolopoulou Kakavoyanni, the water level was above 50 meters in the Middle Neolithic to decrease below the 50 meters during the Bronze Age. Making the inundation simulation, with the exception of a few island-like settlements within the lake, most of the rest respected the 64 meter elevation from two level, despite the seasonal periodic floods of the lake. Taking into account the effects of catastrophic flooding expected in the area and assuming the similar episodes were regularly repeated even during the Neolithic period, it is logical to question the persistence of habitation in flood-prone areas. The role of collective memory of the population has been accepted to play a critical role in adaptation to expected flood risks or other catastrophic episodes. Still, a number of socio-hydrological models have been developed to examine the flood memory decay with time. A recent study in the area of Vltava River catchment in the Czech Republic examined the role of the historical collective memory of extreme past events. Taking into account 1,293 settlements found in the course of 8 centuries, between 1118 AD to the end of the 19th century, and taking into account 7 extreme catastrophic flooding events, they concluded that flood memory fades away within 2 generations. The Yongjiru and Kipreu data going back to 1684 catastrophic flooding episodes indicate a periodicity of about 25 to 50 years, well within the above limits of historical hydrological collective memory. Actually, the geoarchaeological study of Van Nandel, Kailis, and Vexis at Platiana Villa Zarku indicated that flooding was occurring much more frequently than a generation. Thus, the flooding episodes may have been well imprinted in the collective memory of the inhabitants, and taking into account the persistence of habitation in the flood-prone areas, the perseverance that could be justified by a cost-benefit decision-making, such as the need to be in the vicinity to water resources and fertile grounds, we do expect that the population of the settlements may have taken specific flood risk mitigation measures and increased their seasonal flood preparedness level by constructing and maintaining the ditches. Having collected all these data sets that depict the internal distribution of architecture within the settlements, gives us an opportunity as a methodological approach to investigate their internal structure. For example, independent of how clustered the houses were, all of the inhabitants had to have access to the main routes leading outwards the exits of the settlement. How easy was this access and how integrated was the population within the settlement? Knobnia tried to investigate the central and auxiliary communication within the settlement of Trine Studine in Serbia through visual inspection. On the other hand, we have a number of tools from Space Index that can contribute in inferring some patterns of internal organization of the settlements in a more sufficient way. Despite the flaws of Space Index analysis, we can adopt the suggestion of Katic and consider it as a tool to think with. Cristina Marchetti experimented with a few Neolithic settlements, starting from our geophysical results and incorporated also 3D visibility analysis. In order to do this, a three-dimensional reconstruction of the architectural remains of the settlements was carried out in 3D Studio Max and georeferenced on the actual digital elevation model of the area, where observers were placed at regular intervals of 10 meters. From a spatial analysis perspective, the results demonstrate that the constructions of the investigated Neolithic sites were kind of segregated, not well connected, and at the same time, they were seeking a visual exclusion from the external environment. But I will not comment further on this, as there is going to be a presentation of the International Computer Applications in Archaeology Conference in June, explaining the details of such kind of analysis. Similar work has been carried out also by Thurpold in 32 early Neolithic settlements located mainly in Anatolia and Greece, which showed two distinct categories of settlements. The older, the very early Neolithic Anatolian villages were shown to have a multi-level organization, concentrated residence and temporal stability, compared to the later Neolithic Balkan villages that exhibited a centralized spatial organization with a more flexible settlement arrangement. In between, there has been also noticed the transition type of settlements. The classification parameters of Foucault were defined mainly by the formalization that has been done by Banning for the prehistoric settlements of the Levantine. Till the confinement of the analysis on the existing excavation plans or on speculations based on the surface distributions of finds without any further solid base of the structural remains, create unavoidable rough estimates of the particular metrics. As more and more excavation and geophysical prospection plans are available, it was interesting to expand this particular model and apply it in the area of Thessaly, Macedonia, and the rest of the Balkans. The 24 subcategories considered by Foucault expanded to 94 to consider not only the internal layout of structure, but also attributes such as the number of ditches and enclosures, the total area of settlement, the existence of central courtyard, the existence of tells, flat settlements or both, proximity to water resources, usage, namely proposing a more general landscape index. Correspondence analysis is employed to try to isolate eigenvectors that could best differentiate the spatial attributes of the settlements. Even if this is a work in progress, and obviously we understand that it will take quite a lot of time to populate it with a critical mass of available data, we can have a small taste of the results for the three periods of the Neolithic, where we can see some differentiation being formed as we move from Thessaly to the north. It's apparent that the results of the geophysical prospection, especially when it is employed in the manifold manner and in tandem with satellite aerial remote sensing and GIS spatial analysis, are capable in providing a number of details of the interior and off-site micro-region of the settlements depicting their evolution in the wider landscape, something that cannot be easily carried out through excavations. On the other hand, the results of the geophysical prospection are accompanied with a certain degree of uncertainty, despite the coherent pictures we are acquiring from the different sites. What geophysical prospection results present is a frozen image of the last historical snapshot of the settlements that may even contain traces from previous periods. The geophysical visibility, or let's say myopia, is limited with respect to the thickness of the anthropogenic deposits and the number of habitation faces. It is really hard to provide details of the construction of faces, the continuity, discontinuity period of habitation in a long time frame, or distinguish the domestic and non-domestic function of the specific structures without excavations. Also, most of the settlements that have been examined through geophysical prospection belong to the eastern fringes of Thessaly, and in order to have a much more integrated picture of the whole area, there is a need definitely to expand to the rest of the region, both in the valleys and the surrounding hills. I will end up our voyage to Neolithic Thessaly somewhere here, hoping that it was of some interest to you as it was to all of the team members that participated in it. There is plenty of work that can be done based on the acquired data, so you may hear more on this in the future. But before ending the particular presentation, let me take the opportunity just to mention our new graduate program on Geoinformatics in Digital Humanities, which is expected to start in September. And we are expecting to officially announce it and launch the related website in the next few days. So if there are any interested students that want to take a hardcore training of part of what we have shown today, they are more than welcome to apply. Special thanks, of course, to all the people who participated and still are in this project, and hopefully we shall see more of this research to be carried out in the region. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Apostole. Thank you very much. I am sure this was to everybody's interest. Despite our difficulty in hearing you, especially during the beginning of your lecture, I'm sure everyone appreciated your multidimensional approach and analysis to the intra-site organization of the settlements in the coast of Neolithic Thessaly, including GIS modeling, space syntax, and I think 3D viewshed analysis. That was all very interesting, and I'm sure that we will have an interesting discussion with you from our participants. Everybody can type in their question or comment to Apostolos using the chat function at the bottom of your screen, or you can simply raise your hand and unmute your microphone and your camera so that you can speak to our speaker directly. Apostolos, you may switch on your camera now. And
I try.
Interaction. Great. You on the fantastic view of the sea. Okay. considering that some people face difficulties in hearing you, especially in the very in the first minutes of your lecture, this is the time, everyone, for you to make a question, to address a question to Apostolos in case something was not clear, or if you want to ask him something in particular. Well, let me inform everyone that our lectures for this semester, as we usually do, will be posted on our on the Archaeological Research Unit's YouTube channel, and you will have the chance to listen to Apostolos' lecture again in your own at your own convenience anytime afterwards. The lecture will be available tomorrow, the day after tomorrow, on our YouTube channel. So are there any questions or comments to our speaker, please? Okay. Jens Seith has perhaps mistakenly posted a question to myself in private, so I can read it out. It seems to me that few of the sites have continued into the early Bronze Age, into the early and middle Bronze Age. Why is this? This is a question, Apostolos, for you.
Sorry, say that again.
It seems to Ian that a few of these sites have continued into the early and middle Bronze Age. Why is this?
I don't think I can give some kind of explanation here. I mean, the sites were either deserted, they were left abandoned, and then there was a reoccupation. We don't know in what kind of frequency, we don't know what was the intensity of habitation. This is something that we can only achieve through excavations. I'm afraid geophysics cannot provide more than what we have done here. This is why it is necessary geophysical research to be accompanied, to be working together with excavation. There's no other way to arrive to a better result. We have to understand this, that yes, we get a picture, the first picture of what exactly is going on beneath the ground, but geophysics is not panacea. It's not going to provide us all the answers. Let's put it like that.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you, Apostole. There is a question by Anastasia Papadopoulou. The differentiation between two generations also concerns Greece. I'm not sure I understand the question. So if you would mind unmuting your microphone, Mrs. Papadopoulou, so that you can ask Apostolos directly. Meaning, do the settlements in floodplains, as she continues, return to dangerous positions after two generations? This is a question rephrased.
Well, the study that has been done, at least in the Czech Republic, concerned only a specific kind of area. Based on this, we don't have any kind of similar, at least I don't know, if we have a similar kind of studies in the area of Greece. Or in other places, maybe there is one also in England that I have seen, but it doesn't go backwards so much. However, taking the example from the Czech Republic, what happens is that we see that the people are reluctant to reoccupy the same site that has been flooded within one generation, but they are starting returning slowly to the same areas that they have been flooded after two generations or a little bit less. At least these are the results that they have, they came up with respect to the study of all these settlements throughout the period of 8th-9th centuries, and taking into consideration catastrophic flooding events. Not just extensive flooding events, but catastrophic flooding events.
Okay, thank you. Anastasia, if you wish, you can come back with another question. Another question goes, you mentioned that you cored various sites. Did you do other analysis or any paleoclimate reconstructions?
I'm afraid not.
Okay, very clear.
That was one of the propositions we tried to have for the second phase of it. I mean, the paleo-environmental reconstruction would be something crucial to understand not only the climate change in the long term, but also abrupt changes of the climate within small time sections that we can also correlate with respect to specific habitation layers. And this kind of study could also provide us the curves of how the temperature has fluctuated in specific regions, but also the differentiation between arid and humid periods of climate throughout the scale of habitation. But first of all, this is a very expensive model to do. It needs a program which needs to be almost completely devoted for taking the course and making the isotope analysis. And you understand that this is something that we want to include in the future. And I hope this is going to be included, at least in one of the projects that we can do or other people can do in the region, for sure.
Wonderful. Thank you. Evangelos Kundis asks, couldn't it be a hint for social hierarchy that some people lived in the center of the settlement, the higher ground, or the most protected space? Who decides who stays where in the settlement?
Obviously, I cannot answer this as well. this kind of research that not only our research, but also the results we are getting from excavations, mm-hmm. I think they are not straightforward to address such kind of questions, especially who decides. How can we know that? I mean, this is a little bit hard to understand. With respect to social hierarchy, we do not have, at least from what I know, I think the rest of the archaeologist colleagues that they are here, they can have a much better opinion on this, but I haven't seen any kind of results dealing with arriving to the conclusion that there is a hierarchy, let's say, during the Neolithic period. However, there are signs of a kind of an organization, and this is something that we do have. I mean, people are organized to go and live somewhere together. They have to be organized to construct, maintain these large earthworks like the ditches. They have to be organized together to bring timber from remote areas, to put it in the houses, and a large quantity of it, and just burn down the specific houses. So definitely there is an organization, but I don't think that we can have signs of hierarchy here. Despite the fact that there are some megaron type, let's say, of buildings that they have been found in some of the sites, I don't think we can arrive to such kind of a conclusion about hierarchy in the Neolithic period, especially in Thessaly or maybe even elsewhere.
Although I'm not a specialist on the period, I would think that the material culture perhaps from these different sites might give an indication of settlement hierarchy, if that existed indeed, but that we cannot know unless there is an excavation and the material has been thoroughly studied by the specialists. Right, there is Apostole, I believe, a comment from Siham Yunsi. Paleoclimatic variations could give good indications also on the mobility, in fact, he says.
Correct, absolutely, yes.
Okay.
Not only mobility in the short range, but also in the long range. So it would be interesting to have such kind of coring to make reconstructions of the paleoclimate, but not only for Thessaly, not only for the micro region of Thessaly, but it would be perfect to see over a larger geographical region. I think this is going to give us also a new window of knowledge with respect to the large scale mobility.
Mm-hmm. Great. Okay. I think Apostole, I'm just quickly checking our chat, just in case I missed a question. There is obviously many comments, congratulating comments from everyone here for your fascinating presentation. You will have the time to go through them afterwards. Right. We do have another question from Anastasia Papadopoulou. The settlement sites in those regions that are being flooded are still in use. Do they continue from later on, lasting for more than a generation?
Yeah, this is also the something that we cannot conclude, because we do not excavate, so we don't know if a site that has been flooded and the degree of destruction or the degree of flooding that exists in a particular region has been abandoned for some period of time, or if it was partially destroyed within the areas of the ditches were filled, and then the population remained and tried to sustain, to maintain the ditches. We do not have such kind of formation. At least this is not information that geophysical prospection can provide.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Thank you. There is a question and comment, a very specific one from Anaya Sarpaki, who also thanks you for your great lecture. Zerelia, which you mentioned as being published in 1908, but the University of Thessaly at Iklia Grafioti excavated the site up to the present. As it is a strange site with several Neolithic figurines and finds of metal, as far as she remembers, is there a different organization of this settlement compared to the others?
Yeah, Anaya, you are absolutely right. This would be something that everybody would expect. You have the two natural lakes. You have the tell, which is one of the very high tells in the region. Anyway, it's a landmark for sure. We have multiple phases of habitation in this area. We have done extensive survey around the region, also the region connecting the tell with the two lakes, and also on the other side of the tell. We have signs of a few houses, of a few structures around the settlement, but definitely not such kind of so obvious number of factors to suggest an extended flat settlement, right? It's we don't have such kind of signs, which is very surprising, right? Very surprising. We were expecting something like that, and also there are no wide ditches around the area. We have done a survey at least two, three times, if I remember correctly. Yeah. Nothing.
Mm-hmm. Great. And she replies, "Thank you, Apostle. That was a satisfactory answer then." Are there any questions from, would you also like to speak to Apostolos in person? Just feel free to unmute your microphone and switch on your camera. Apostolos, I'm really amazed by the depth of your work. I mean, considering the wide range of applications, digital tools, approaches and methods that you employ in the case of Thessaly that we all heard about, It's amazing the insights one can get by combining all these, everything you have just mentioned. And so much we can learn, so much more we can learn about this prehistoric period, let alone if we had to deal with a historical period where textual sources and other kinds of evidence help to actually filter this kind of insights one can get from the approaches you just mentioned. So this is fantastic, and I hope there will be chances in the future that you do that, and I'm sure you probably do, with other sides of the historical periods. Are there any other questions, please, or comments for Apostolos? There is one from our colleague Urania Kuka.
No cemeteries.
Yes.
I'm sorry. It's let's put it like that. Not in terms of IGN project, but we had a chance to survey in Platia Magoulas Arku, the area where the so-called cemetery was, very, very weak suggestions, let's say, even from geophysical data. The rest of the sites we surveyed, we had maybe also evidence also in the beginning, from what I remember, but that was on the side, on the area of the small slopes, the small slopes that we are away from the Magoula. But in general, no lack with respect to the cemeteries. And actually, we were focusing on the tales themselves, the Magoulas themselves, and the surrounding region. So it was, let's put it like that, that the archaeologists, Bakarodi, Kostas Mouzatsakis, and the rest of the team, were those that they were guiding us based on the surface distribution material that has been found in different sites. And we were targeting at the particular regions, but we were expanding much more because we wanted not only to focus on the Magoula itself, but also to the rest of the surrounding.
Great. Thank you, Apostole. Yes, that has answered Urania's question. While giving a little more time to our audience to type in their question, I would like to remind everyone that this was the final lecture of our public lecture series for this semester. We will continue, of course, as we always do, next semester with another lecture series, this time still celebrating our 30th birthday of the Archaeological Research Unit. Next semester by all our postdoctoral researchers. However, there is another question by Anastasia Papadopoulou. The lack of cemeteries could have in the region would have an effect on the flooding. What is your opinion? Meaning that there may have been no material remains because of the flooding.
Well, I think there are excavations of monolithic graves in different areas, so I don't think this is the case. Let's not forget the following, that the flooding, what happens with the flooding is that it erodes a little bit of the material, but in most of the cases, it deposits more material as well. So if we take into account that the inhabitants were aware of the floodings, they would place the cemeteries in places that they were not susceptible of the floodings. And again, I will take the chart from Platia Magoulas Arku, because the so-called area of the cemetery is away from the tail, and it is on a smooth ridge. It's actually a little bit elevated with respect to the rest of the areas. So I'm pretty sure that the cemeteries were harder to locate.
Sorry, Apostle, can you repeat the last part of your answer, please, because there was an interruption.
So that it's harder. It's not that they don't exist or they have been vanished, but it is harder to locate them. Okay. Both the survey and also with your physical survey as well.
Mm-hmm. Great, thank you. Right. Well, there are a few problems with probably your connection, Apostole, but we got the last answer to Anastasia Nikopoulos' question. If there is anyone who would like to say good evening and goodbye to Apostolos and thank him for his fantastic lecture tonight, please feel free and switch on your camera now and your unmute your microphone so that you can just say hello.
Γεια σου, Απόστολε. Ευχαριστούμε.
Γεια σου.
Ευχαριστούμε. Γεια σου, Αποστόλε. Ευχαριστούμε πολύ.
Ευχαριστούμε, Απόστολε.
Συγχαρητήρια.
That is a lively audience, Apostle, isn't it?
Yeah. Very lively. Maybe because it is the last lecture, that's why.
Καληνύχτα.
Καληνύχτα.
Καλό Πάσχα.
No problem. See you back in next semester for all our lectures. Thank you for being here all these months.
Yes.
Καληνύχτα και από